Hello students, my name is Alisha Hashmi, and in the last session we had seen the first part of unit 2, which was marketing information system, marketing research, consumer and industrial markets. Today we will be going through the further topics, which will be segmentation, targeting and positioning. Now, starting off with segmentation. If you talk about market segmentation, it is a process by which you divide the market of your potential customer into small groups. The group can be small or large as per the requirement, but the group will have similar interests, needs or the same location. When you talk about segment, it should be useful. To be useful, a market segment should be measurable. Measurable in the sense you should be able to know its size, the purchasing power of the customer and the profiles of the segment. Then it should be accessible. That means it should be easy to reach and to be served. Substantial, which refers to the fact that markets are large and profitable enough to serve. If the segment does not give you that much of profit, it is of no use to you. Then it should be differentiable. That means it should be distinguishable and you can respond differently to the marketing mix element. Now, what is marketing mix? Place, promotion, price and product. Then actionable, that the effective programs can be designed and it should be attractive for the customer so that they can get attract and they can buy your product and you will be able to serve them. So when you talk about a segment, the segment should be measurable, it should be accessible, it should be substantial, it should be differentiable and actionable. Now, there are various levels of marketing. The first level is segment marketing. What happens is the market segments of large groups of similar wants, purchasing power, geographical location, their buying attitude, buying habits, buying behaviors. On that basis, some segment marketing is done. Then second, another level is niche marketing. Now, niche is a small market where you can also say it is an untapped market where the needs of the customer are not properly fulfilled. So you have an upper edge that you can go and capture that market by delivering the desired needs. Then there is local market. Local market basically is if you are living in an area, you will find small shops nearby. They can be of general stores, stationeries. There are sometimes vegetable shops also. So all these comes into local marketing. Then comes individual marketing. This is customized marketing or one-to-one marketing. You are actually customizing your product as per the need of an individual customer. Many a times you will feel that if you want a certain, for example, you are going to buy a gift item for your mother. So if you want to customize that item, you will have your certain needs that you need to, you know, need that picture in that particular item, or if you want to, you know, purchase a cake, for example. So what you do is you tell them that I need this shaped cake and the flavor should be this. So that is customized marketing or one-to-one marketing. Now, when you talk about market segmentation, you can segment the consumer market geographically, according to the demographic, according to psychographic and behavioral. We'll see all these things in further slides. Then geographic segmentation basically means dividing the market into categories as per nations, regions, states, countries. For example, you'll find an area which is a rural area. In rural area, the need of agriculture, if it is the area of agricultural land, and the most of the people are actually having the occupation of a farmer. So you will be it will be easy for you to go there and sell equipments and pesticides and fertilizers. So what did you do? You actually divided geographically the segment ki in this area our products will be sold. If you come to the urban area and you try to sell equipments which are useful for agriculture, you will not get the buyers here. Okay, now a national marketer may take whole nation. If there is, for example, there are products like salt, detergents, soaps, your toothpaste, sugar, tea. These are products which are used almost everywhere, whether it is urban, whether it is rural, whether it is in Madhya Pradesh or in Assam or in Tamil Nadu. These things are common. So that will be like you have captured the whole nation. Now, there are times that some products are used not only in India but in other countries also. For example, if you talk about McDonald's, the McDonald's has opened its stores not only in India but also abroad. So it has captured the whole globe. Then if you talk about Spider-Man, it is a movie which is not, which is released in almost all the countries. If you talk about India, catering to India's need, it is even released in local languages. Then demographic means dividing the group of people or group of customer based on variables like age, gender, family size, income, occupation, religion, etc. Now when you talk about age, as the age differs, the needs and requirements of the customers also differs. For example, when a baby is born, the requirements are generally diapers or toys. As he grows on, the choice of toys also changes. Then if he reaches the teenage level, he's more interested into maybe reading books or playing certain sports. So that keeps on changing. As you reach a level or when you start working, your preferences becomes insurance, mutual funds in order to save. So the choices keeps on changing, and hence depending upon the age, the segmentations also differ. Then gender segmentation is also there. Based on male and female, you will generally find these things into fashion stores where you are actually, difference of clothing can be seen, difference in cosmetics can be seen. Choice of TV channels also differs when you talk about gender. Then income segmentation, we are actually reading all this thing under demographic. So please don't get confused. We are seeing all these segmentation under demographic segmentation only. Alright, now when you talk about income, there are people who have low income, who have middle income, that is middle class, and some who have very high income and very high income. So their choices differ. For example, if you talk about transportation, the person with low income will prefer maybe bus or maybe public transport. But if you talk about a person who is into middle, he might prefer an auto or a taxi maybe. And the people who are having high income, they will have their own vehicles. So even if they have to go out somewhere, they will prefer private taxis who can take them to their destination. Then social class is also a segmentation, because heritage hotels have come up nowadays. If you talk about in Bhopal only, if you talk about Noorud Sabha, it is categorized as heritage hotel. Not everybody goes and stays there, but social class, if your pocket allows, you'll definitely try that out. Okay, then we have psychographic segmentation. We have completed demographic, now we are coming to psychographic. Now this depends upon your social class will also be here, your lifestyle, your personality, the values that you have got from your family. All these things will come into psychographic segmentation. Alright, so here we complete segmentation. Now, when you segment a market, what do you do? you actually try to find out which place, which region, which age group, or what kind of category of people will actually be liking your product and where they will be found. Once you have segmented them, it is important to target them. Alright, now target basically means selection of potential customers to whom the business actually wishes to sell the product. Excuse me. Now, there are two factors of targeting. First, the segment overall attractiveness. How attractive that segment is. How much profit will I earn from that? And second is company's objective and resources. Will the company be able to reach that segment? Does the company have that transportation facilities? Is the objective of the company to earn profit or to provide facility to the customers? Both these things actually define the targeting of any product or service. How do we select the target market? After evaluating various segments which we have found out in the segmentation, the company decides how many segments to offer the product or service. Now, there are five patterns through which targeting is actually done. As you can see in this picture, you're finding various grids. Here, M1, M2, M3 is the market 1, market 2 and market 3. P1 is product 1, P2 is product 2 and P3 is product 3. Alright, now what is done? There are five ways you can capture a market or you can target a market. The first one is single segment concentration, in which you select a single segment and you cater to its needs. In the second one is selective specialization. What do we do here is we select two or three or four segments maybe, and a few number of segments are selected and the needs are catered there. Then comes product specialization. You select one product which you feel is, the segment of all the, you have markets and all the market have segments in which that one single product can be sold. So you cater to product and you select segments in the market to sell that product. Then comes market specialization. You select one market and you sell all your products in that single market only. You do not go out to the second market. And last one is full coverage, full market coverage, wherein you do not select any segment or any market. You full-fledgedly try to sell your product in the entire markets, all the markets and all the products. We'll see that in elaborately now. When you talk about single segment concentration, the firm does what? He selects a segment, he researches that segment and then achieves profit by targeting that one single segment. Now in this, competitors may invade the segment also. Alright, now invade the segment means you are catering to a single segment. If you have a strong competitor, you have chances to go into loss. So, in single segment, what do? You are actually targeting just one segment. Example of this is tractors, alright? Tractors, you select a segment which has the maximum area of agricultural land and you try to sell the product there only, alright? Now, selective specialization. Firm select number of segments which they feel that they are more profitable and they can be, the customers will be more attracted towards their product. Now here what do you do is, diversify the firm's risk. Matlab, it can happen that in one particular segment you are able to perform good, in another segment you are performing very very good, while in the third segment you are performing moderately. So these risks are there. Now it's the example of it can be McDonald's. How McDonald's, because McDonald's have opened their stores in many locations. Now it might happen that in Mumbai and Delhi the profit range is quite high, on the other hand in Bhopal the profit range may be moderate. So this is an example of selective specialization. Now we come to product specialization. What we have done is we have selected, we make a certain product and sell it to the different market segment. For example, Avenger, you are selling in market one, Discover Platinum in third, like that. What happens, for example, now see, if we take an example of a four-wheeler, all right, and it is being sold in various segments depending upon various market segments. So that you have selected a product and you're selling in separate markets. That is product specialization. Then come market segmentation. The firm concentrate on serving many needs of a particular customer group. All right, now the most important example here is Himalaya. Various products are there, various needs are fulfilled. Now, there is a single customer base. For example, we talk about Johnson's and Johnson's baby products. Johnson's and Johnson's are selling soap also, shampoo also, oil also. All these products are baby products and they are selling it to the one market base. All right. So this is market specialization. You select a market, your customer base is the babies, the parents of the babies who will buy product for their kids. So you have selected one market and you have number of products which you are selling in that same market. In product specialization, what do we do? We deliver number of product in different market segments. For example, if we talk about income segmentation, for example, so we have launched, for example, a vehicle is launched, a four-wheeler is launched, and you have launched one basic model, one average model and one high model. So this will cater to all the market needs. The product is one very in meager modification is there. You are catering to various market needs with the same product. All right, so you understood product and market are not same. In product you are choosing a single product and you are catering to needs of various markets. Whereas in market specialization, you are selecting one market and various products are there to fulfill the needs of that single market. Now, full coverage. Here, all customers of all the groups you feel like fulfilling the needs. The large firms afford full market. For example, HUL or ITC. Here, I have written an example of Coke and Pepsi because all the people, may it be kids, may it be the teenagers, may it be adults, may it be senior citizens, everybody prefer soft drinks. So examples of soft drink is very prominent over here. This is done in two ways. One is undifferentiated marketing and second is differentiated marketing. So we'll see that in our further slides. Okay. Undifferentiated marketing means there are firms who ignore major segment differences and goes after whole market with one product offer. Here you will not find that there are various products. They have selected one product and they are catering to all the buyers. Focus is basically on core buyers rather than the difference the buyers have. All right, for example, if you talk about salt is an example, Tata Salt. The product is same and it is doing undifferentiated marketing because no categorization of low, high or age group or social status is there in that product. Here you will find that competition increases and it is not easy to sustain because same product is there, so it might be possible that there are other competitors who are producing the same product with various variants. So competition here increases and it increases the intensity, if you have number of segments. So what companies do is they focus on large segments and ignore small segments. Even if they are incurring loss in the small segment, they let it go and focus on the large segments. Examples of such products are Tata Salt, Maruti 800, washing powder, and etc. Then we come to differentiated marketing. In this, what happens is the firm operates in different segments and design different product for each segment. In this, competition is comparatively low and companies cater to the needs of the customer. Now, example is, if we can take example of toothpaste. Colgate, if you talk about, you have Colgate Sensitive, which is catering to the need of sensitive teeth. You have Colgate Ved Shakti for herbal use. Then you have Colgate Max Fresh for freshness, and you have Colgate Whitening for whitening the teeth. They have taken out four variants for four different customers who have four problems of tooth. So these tooth problems are actually solved by variants which a company has launched. So that can be categorized into differentiated marketing. I hope I'm clear. So now we will be starting with positioning, which is the last topic. Segmenting, what we have done, we have found out the segments after researching. Different segments are categorized. Once the segments are categorized and different segments are found out, we target as to which segment will give us the most of profit, which segment we are trying to cater. Once targeting is done, we try to find out which pattern we will follow in targeting. Once targeting is done, then we come to positioning. Positioning basically means designing company's offering and image to occupy a distinctive place in the mind of target market. Now, when you have a target market, you need to understand how you need to build your image in order to attract customer. So basically, you play with the mind of the customer, and you position your product and your brand image in such a way that it becomes important for and mandatory for the customer to come and see your product, and if attracted towards your product will definitely buy it. For example, Vicks Action 500. There is still no competition of Vicks Action 500, and it is placed like if you have cold, you use Vicks. Similarly, Pond's cream was the first cream, cold cream. So still now there are many, many customers who still prefer Pond's. The image has been built up till date. Positioning, you can say, is what the brand stands for in the mind of customer. If the customer trusts your brand, then your product and your organization is positioned in the right way in the mind of the customer. Now, if you talk about example, you can take example of Domino's pizza. It says a hot pizza will be delivered to you in 30 minutes at a moderate price. So that is value proportion here. You have played with the mind of the people that you are giving value of your product, that too in the right time and at a very moderate cost. Positioning, you can say, customer focused value proportion should be there. If you are focusing on the customer need and the value he would like to offer for that particular product, then the positioning is done right. Positioning requires that similarities and differences between the brands can be defined and communicated. You should be able to justify the differentiation between your competitors to the customers. If you are able to define that properly, proper positioning will take place. Positioning basically gives the customer through reason to buy. There are times when you a person do not need certain product, but getting attracted towards the image that is being built, towards the how the product is being positioned, he is forced to buy the product or attracted to buy the product. not what you do to the product, it is what you do to the mind of the perspective. You need to be very careful when you're talking about positioning. You're not changing anything in the product, you're not doing anything to the product. You are actually playing with the mind of the customer. How customers judge a product's value relative to the competitors is the ability to deliver against promise. That means the customer should be satisfied that you are better than the competitor, and whatever you are delivering better than the competitor at a better price also. So when you talk about positioning, positioning is basically giving value proposition to the customers. Customers focused value proposition. Now there are various strategies of positioning which are used for proper and effective positioning. Okay, so now we'll see what are the various positioning strategies. The first one is attribute positioning. In this, what happens is we use one or more product attributes, features or benefits, and that the brand can deliver better than the competitors. Here in positioning, we need to focus on our competitors also. For example, if you talk about Himalaya, all right, what do we do is Himalaya is also manufacturing neem soap, and Medimix is also manufacturing neem soap. So what Himalaya does is he gives better elaborate detailed information of neem, of various other ingredients, Ayurvedic ingredients that are used in the soap. What he is trying to do is he is trying to bring Himalaya neem soap over Medimix, over competitors, by giving various features and attributes about their product. Then comes price and quality positioning. In this, what we do? We tell the customer, we try to attract them on the fact that the quality, you're getting a good quality product at a certain price. Now, this happens in both the cases. For example, if you talk about watches, you get a good quality product at a low end also, like Timex, Sonata, etc. And you go for higher also, like Armani, or you can say Rolex. These watches are example of both the things. You are getting quality at a fixed or at a reliable price. So here both the things are seen, the quality and the price you are paying for that quality. Then you have application positioning or use positioning. Here the product is positioned by how it is used or applied. For example, nowadays it is an era of social media. So when you talk about social media, what comes to your mind at first instance? Your photographs. So nowadays mobile phones have been positioned in the way as to what or which mobile phone is giving the best camera shots. So that is how it is being used, how you can get the best pictures out of it. So this is application positioning. Then you have product user positioning. This type of positioning is basically done where you associate the product with a particular type of user. For example, you market protein shakes. Who will have protein shakes? The customers who are going to a gym, or maybe into fit, who are fitness freak, who are using those products. Not everybody will go for protein shakes. So you have targeted the product as per the user. Then you have usage and use time positioning. Now what happens here is you choose to attract your customer on the basis of when to use that particular product. What is the purpose of the product? When you should use the product? For example, if you go for Livon serum, all right, it is marketed as using it after washing your hair, so you will get frizz-free hair. So what they have done, they have used a usage time positioning concept. Then you have product class positioning. This is associated with specific group of products, usually which are not given conventional association. For example, there are a number of soaps in the market. But when you talk about Neutrogena, they never market their soaps like Neutrogena soaps. They always call it Neutrogena Beauty Bars. So what they have done, they are selling the same product, but with not with conventional theory. Instead of soap, they have brought a new theory, which is known as beauty bars. All right. Now, then we have category positioning. This involves making product which can jump over the category of origin where it originally belongs to. Now, the example can be, for example, cycle is nowadays associated with fitness. The more you do cycling, the more fit you become. So, the company who was marketing, manufacturing bicycles have now come up into the product line of fitness shakes or protein shakes. So what they have done, they have jumped over the category which they were producing, but under the same name and same zone, that is fitness, they have brought another product. So they have positioned according to that. Then you have benefit positioning. In this, the products are bought for specific benefits. If you get that, you will have these benefits. For example, people who do not eat Maggi just for the sake that it has a white flour, it is made up of white flour or maida, the company brought veg atta Maggi for them, telling that you will have health benefits also because you are eating atta now. So this is benefit positioning. Then you have competitive positioning. Now, competitive positioning basically means that you are bringing a product and doing the positioning of it with reference to the competitor. For example, Parle Agro has launched a product, a drink of lemon. Lemon, it was the named as lemon. So, what did... Sorry guys, my mic got disconnected. So I was telling that Parle Agro has launched a lemon energy drink which was named as Neeboos, and that Neeboos was launched with reference to lemon which was already in the market. So they positioned it as to we have added masala flavor to Neeboos and you will feel that authentic flavor of lemon drink. So they have positioned it that way. Then you have corporate identity positioning. In this case, the brand actually uses a specific brand name. And what do it do? It plays with the brand positioning. What it does is, for example, HUL, all the products that you buy which are manufactured under the head of HUL or under the umbrella of HUL, you will find that there is a tagline written, a quality product of HUL. So you are playing with the mind of the customer with the help of the brand name HUL. So here you use a single corporate entity, identity, and you are positioning the product that way. And the last one is brand endorsement positioning. In this, you use a successful brand and you take a new entry. For example, Dabur has launched hair oil Vatika and shampoo also Vatika. So it doesn't say Dabur Vatika, it says Vatika. So they have brought a new brand itself and they are using it for positioning, a new brand basically. I hope I'm clear with all the positioning strategies. We'll revise it once again. In attribute, you position all the products with the help of different attributes. In price quality, you see right quality at the right price. Then application positioning is basically how that product is applied or used, for which purpose. Then product user positioning is depending upon the user, you position your product. Then time positioning, use time positioning is when you are supposed to use that product. Product class positioning means when you are positioning your product not in the conventional association but with a separate different categorization. Then you have category positioning, wherein what you do is you position your product with another categorization. That means with the same product you are actually categorizing into different form or category. Then you have benefit positioning, the products that are brought with their benefits. Then you have competitive positioning, when you position your product with reference to your competitor. Then you have corporate identity positioning, when you use your corporate identity to position your product in the minds of the customer. And then you have brand endorsement positioning, where you use a separate brand to endorse your product. Okay, so now the last topic of this unit is procedure of positioning. How do you position your product? It has a separate process and it starts from competitors. Actually, it is written competitors' advantage, but it is actually competitors' identification. Who are your competitors? And competitors are not just the ones who are direct, you can see directly, who are into the production or manufacturing of your the product you want to launch, but also the prospective competitors who can come up in the field along with you. So once you know who are your competitors, you go for the second step, wherein you define how competitors are perceived and evaluated. In this step, you see the how they are perceived by the customers. What image does the customer hold of that particular competitor? What attributes are they giving? Are they able to fulfill the needs of the customer? Everything is seen here and evaluated. Once that is done, you define the competitor's position. How? You include yourself and then you decide where do you stand. How well will you be able to position yourself in the customer's mind? Once that is done, you analyze the customer's preferences. Which segmentation? You need to segment your market. You need to find customers are actually looking for in that segment, how you will be able to fulfill their needs. Is your product the ideal product that they are looking for? How you can improve? Once that is done, you make positioning decisions. What kind of decisions will they be? Is the segment strategy appropriate? The resources that we have, are they appropriate and sufficient to communicate with our customer? How strong is our competitor? Are we ready with our strategies to fight with them? Is the current positioning strategy that we have made will work, or we need to change those strategy or modify those strategy? All the decisions are taken in this step. Then the last step is, once you have done this, you need to monitor. When the position has been established, it is necessary to monitor how well it is actually maintained in the marketplace. If it is not maintained, you need to change your strategies. You might have to change your segmentations also, your targeting also. So coming back to the procedure, we'll just revise it. First, you need to see, identify the customers to which you will be competitors, who will be like giving you neck to neck competition. Then you need to see how well they are being perceived by the customer. Is the product able to satisfy the needs of the customer?
You need to evaluate your customer's positioning in the minds of the customer. Then you determine the competitor's position. Here you put yourself also into the competition, and then you decide as to where do you stand? What are the customers looking for, and how they will be positioning you and the competitors along? Then you need to analyze customers' preferences. What are their actual needs? What are they actually looking for? What are their preferences? Once that is done, then you take certain positioning decision as to, is the resources sufficient? Are we positioning in the right segment? Will we be able to give them the fulfill the needs of the customers? Once you have done the positioning, is being established, then you see, then you monitor the positioning. If you feel you are done a good job and satisfactory performance is happening in perspective to positioning, then all you need to do is maintain those positioning. If you are not able to maintain the positioning, you need to formulate new strategies or modify the existing strategies in order to position your product in a proper way. So with this, we have finished our second unit, and hope you are able to understand what are the contents of the unit. In case you have any doubt, contact me and ask and clear your doubts. Now we will be starting our third unit in our next session. So soon you will get the video of that also. Till then, you stay safe, stay home, and prepare well for your examination. Do not waste time. Instead, utilize your time by giving your 100% towards your studies and preparation. Okay, thank you.